1,000 years of Western music backwards. Lecture 14, the High Baroque, and the music of Handel and Bach.
We left with a giant, one of the giants, the unsung giant, C.P.E. Bach. And C.P.E. Bach was a composer who, we're going to now find out where he came from. But what we know is from last week, he was a composer who was trying to figure out, how do I get lots of emotions in one piece? And how do I have something that's broken off into a lot of pieces, and yet it all somehow holds together? That's what he did, and that is an unbelievably monumental accomplishment. Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, forget anything they did without this guy coming up with it. So when we listen to it, we listen to it the way we do in this class. We listen to it in the context of Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven. So we were able to say, oh, it doesn't completely hold together right. You know, it seems to be kind of scattered. Here's the symphony in B minor again. That changes. Totally different music again. Third change. Can you even remember how it started? Probably not. So gentle suddenly. Here's how it started, just in case you forgot. So his style was called the sensitive style, Empfindsamkeit, highly expressive style. And we say, well, it's kind of hard to follow, but what is so extraordinary, it's some of the most expressive music ever written. And if you spend time getting to know it, you'll start to feel it, and you'll start to notice, oh my gosh, it's not as disjunct as I thought. Because that boom, 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 that's actually going through the whole piece in its own little way. He's taking little pieces and developing them, but he's doing it in such an original way, it seems like different music. This idea of taking things and cutting into pieces within one piece of music is an extraordinary idea. And I'm sure he didn't invent it. It was going on at the time. Why did it happen? Well, tonight you'll understand what he was rebelling from. Because the music you hear tonight is not going to do that. The music tonight, every piece starts with one emotion and ends with the same emotion. In fact, they had a word for it. They called it an affect, A-F-F-E-C-T. And that was kind of an aesthetic rule during this time, that you started with one feeling, and that was the feeling. And if you wanted a new feeling, you started a different piece of music. And so the verb that I learned for this style of music was Fortspinnung, spinning out, music that spins out. And, you know, the great example of spinning out, I think I played you. It just keeps going. It doesn't stop. Yeah. It just keeps going and going and going. You know, there's exceptions. Of course, there are exceptions. But in general, that's one of the qualities of the Baroque music. And C.P.E. was trying to discover ways of breaking it up. And one of the ways he discovered was to create cadences and things that would be like little demarcations that would let you stop, put pauses in between. And in doing that, he started to realize once you break things up into little pieces, suddenly you have to have some way of balancing them and connecting them. And that became the whole idea. How do we take these pieces now and make them have a larger coherence? And so that's what Haydn and Mozart ended up accomplishing. They took all of this and made this larger coherence. If you remember, we actually talked about this in lecture two, is that jazz, we went back from rock to jazz, and jazz music borrowed from this idea of the Baroque, this concerto grosso, where you start with a pulse that just keeps going. And pop music continued that kind of pulse. So that's absolutely true. There have been some groups that have really tried to monkey around with it. The C.P.E. Bach of rock music, as far as I can tell, is a group called Yes. You know the group Yes? I think they called it fusion rock or something. I can't remember the term they used for it. But it was rock music trying to be classical, and so they would put a lot of different moods within a single song.
How did C.P.E. Bach make his pieces sound like they were a piece.
That's the interesting thing. The way he did it was, as you know, it takes maybe more than one listening, but he found ways of connecting these different things. So it's a great question. If we go back to the piece. Now that sounds very different, but if you notice, the bass is doing the same thing. Bum, 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 bum. So it's really, on one level, it's doing exactly the same kind of music. Just different chords and different melodies. Now he has spaces, but there's two at the bottom. Bum, 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 bum. Okay, I want to go just one little bit farther. Now this seems very different. Bum, bum, bum. But if you remembered the first tune, da da dum ba ba, it's the same thing, but now in major. But you've forgotten it because it took, you know, it was about, you know, 15 seconds earlier. There's the same pulse from the beginning. So the answer to your question is, he managed to carry elements over that allowed it to be part of the same piece. But the changes were so dramatic that on a first listening, at least, or second listening, it's hard to follow. It's hard to follow. Not all his pieces were this dramatic, dramatically different. But why was he doing this? He was trying to find a way to get a wider spectrum of emotions in music. He wanted music to be more expressive. He lived in the time when the piano was invented. And what's so great about the piano is, unlike the harpsichord, the piano has only one layer of loudness. Two if you have two manuals, and then you can hit a lever that plays and play together, so you can have loud and soft. But otherwise, no matter how loud or soft you hit the key on a harpsichord or an organ, or whatever, it's exactly the same. But on a piano, it's not like that. You can be very soft or loud, depending on what you do. And that huge spectrum of expression is what he was trying to bring into music. And he did it quite effectively. It was his idea that allowed for all the wide spectrum of Beethoven's music. Yeah, really, really interesting. So, let's go back. Let's hear what which he was rebelling. So we're going to start around 1730 to 50. I want to give you an idea of what music was like then. Let's first listen to this piece. I hope you know it. So that's George Frideric Handel, and that's music for the Royal Fireworks, okay? And I want you to hold that near. Now listen to this piece. Different than C.P. Bach, right? It starts with a pulse that continues unabated, all right? It clearly has one affect, one emotion. I'm really rigging this. Now I want you to listen. This is yet another one in D major. Magnifica. Notice the pulse. And we'll stay that way all to the end of the piece. Okay, so this is a very different type of music than C.P. Bach, all these pieces. So that was two pieces by Handel and one by J.S. Bach. And notice, they're all in D major. You know, if you know the styles of the composers, you can tell the difference, but it's exactly the same language. It's this explosion of rhythm and pulse, an explosion of love of just the sound of harmony. It's kind of this glory of chords. You know, taking this just delight in the sound of the chords. But you can hear this language is very different than Haydn, Mozart, and Beethoven, and C.P.E. Bach. Let me introduce you then a little bit more to Handel. One of my favorite moments of the Messiah, which is an oratorio, is an instrumental thing. It's a very short moment, but it captures to me this great love of harmony that is so much a part of the Baroque era, this love of one chord falling into another chord, falling into another chord. This is the pastorale. Gorgeous, isn't it? Yeah, just the sheer love of chords. Now, this is something very, very part of this time. You know, the idea that... just the love of this sound. And this era is the era which defines the notion that we call now having a key. Music was not organized now, as we'll discover next week, it had changed from the horizontal to the vertical. There was this tremendous focus now suddenly on how music sounded when sounds were simultaneous. And so instead of the fact you could have one voice going or instead of listening to music as this multiplicity of different melodies, we just heard. It's called vertical because you have these lines. They line up vertically if I was to write them on paper. And how they made melody for the first time in history at this point became a secondary idea. It was how they sounded. And so the question is how one sound got to the other. So instead of music being based on scales, or any of that, or even... much more important that the way one chord went into another one. And that cycle of chords established the sets of a key. So, creating a circle, it just keeps going in a cycle. Creates a center, and that became the overriding aesthetic of this time. And we'll end, and we get to the beginning of this era, we'll end with one of the quintessential pieces that's a cycle, what we musicians call the Taco Bell canon. And it's done semi-affectionately, because if you happen to be the poor cellist that plays Taco Bell canon, you are locked in a cycle of death. Exactly like that. But that's the idea of this time, this sense of a cycle. And so what we're going to hear is, you know, with Handel and Bach, this cycle is extremely complex. But the love of the way one chord falls into another is what this is about. So when we say, oh, it's such a beautiful melody, what we really mean, although we don't know it, is, oh, it's such a beautiful progression of chords. So let me play you a piece that usually reduces me to tears. And that's actually the idea of the piece. This is from Rinaldo, Handel's Rinaldo. And I don't want to give you any of the history of the opera or anything. I just want you to listen to the chords as a song and see if it gets under your skin the way I'm talking about the Baroque it cares about. You get it? Yeah, that piece shot Handel to kind of worldwide fame, and he actually used it in three different operas. He may actually have lifted it. We don't actually know if that was his, but he used it three times. He translated from the German, passed off as new each time, but it's that chord progression. I'm sure the melody's beautiful, but what you're really noticing is... That defines the key. And then we score. And then close. It's very emotional because of the tension and then coming back. Tension. Tension. Release. This circling of a key through all these chords, this emotion, this was the great discovery of the time we're in now. And it was such a thrill. It's called tonality, and they're called tonality because you take a tone and you circle all the chords around that tone. And every chord has its logical place in a certain hierarchy to that central tone. It's a sense where we're constantly going between tension and dissonance to relaxation. And to feel that with chords was something that was really new and exciting. This was the great discovery of this time we were in, that chords could have this kind of a language. And this language continued all the way up, if you remember, to when? Yeah, who destroyed it?
Schoenberg.
Yeah, Schoenberg and Mahler put it to the breaking point, right, and Stravinsky. They were the ones who finally felt it had exhausted itself, but it had lasted 300 years. 300 years is a long time for that. So all our ears are still in this language. And so one of the things I hope you take away from this series is that when you say you like something or you don't like something, what you really are meaning is how close it adheres to this aesthetic and how far it is from the aesthetic. If it veers from the aesthetic too much, you don't like them, you don't like it. You don't think it sounds good. You know, it's really, you know, in other words, you're programmed because of the music these guys were writing at the time. Were that's how powerful it was. So that gives you an idea of George Frideric Handel, who was arguably the most successful composer in history, I will say. The reason I say that is not only that he was fabulously wealthy, but because I can't think of another composer who's had a piece played longer than Handel. I don't think there is, since Messiah was composed in the 18th century, there's never been a year that it hasn't been performed all over the world. I can't think of any other piece that has that claim from that early on. So Handel was the composer when Haydn I told you Haydn had this great moment where he finally was on a concert tour, an impresario got him to London, and that made him world famous because, you know, he was kind of, you know, no one, you're never famous in your own land. And so, you know, Esterhazy and Auster, they kind of made fun of him. But boy, when he was away in London, the Londoners knew he was like this unbelievable genius. He wrote six symphonies to take over there, and he just blew them away. And what they said was, he's, you know, the greatest composer since Handel. And one of the things they did is they took him to Westminster Abbey to hear what? Messiah. And this is documented. Handel gets on his knees, weeping, saying he is the greatest of all, you know, Handel. And there's another great story in music history with Beethoven, where Beethoven was asked pointedly who the greatest composer was. And do you know who he was supposed to say? Can you guess what everyone expected him to say?
Mozart.
And he said Handel.
Really?
And yeah, that's what everyone said to him. Really? And that's exactly what happened. And he said, what about Mozart? He said, I don't want to hear about him. You know, Handel. And they put other names, you know, Haydn, Handel, you know. Even J.S. Bach, Handel. And he said, he is the master of us all. And he says, to him only will I bend the knee. So my guess is he picked that up from Haydn, too. So he was aware of Haydn's unbelievable ability to tap into this emotion and to speak to the whole world, which Handel did repeatedly. Today, of course, in our time, largely since 1830, we really can't see any other composer past Johann Sebastian Bach. If you're a musician, it's kind of like there's Bach. I'm doing this piece, Cosmic Dust, you know, it's about the stars. And one of the things you study about the solar system is that our old ideas, like when I was a kid, you made a little diorama you know, the solar system, there's the sun, and there's, you know, Venus, and you kind of put it all out there, and now you discover that that was so far removed from the reality of the distances in the solar system, and that, in fact, the distance from the greatest planets is so vast, it's so incredibly vast, you can't even think of it as being in this tight concentric circle. It's kind of silly. That's the way we look at Bach now. You know, it's kind of like the sun with Bach, and then these planets so far out you can't see them. That's where Haydn, Mozart, and Beethoven, and all these others live. And that's kind of how we look at Bach now. That was not the way he was viewed during his lifetime. So I played you the Magnificat. Let me show you Bach's range of emotion. So that same piece that has this kind of, you know, the Baroque was known as this period of ornate decoration. If you think of Baroque churches, it's just the gold dripping and you know, all kinds of arabesque. You know, just all kinds of, it's just chock full with decoration. And everything, and that Magnificat that we played, I'll just review it, has all that decoration in it. Everything's going on at one time. In fact, when you listen to Bach's real grand gestures, it's hard to even hear all of the music that's going on, because there's like four or five melodies going on with three or four bass patterns and about three or four accompaniments. So it's chock full. A good example is the Brandenburg Concerto number 2. Now you're hearing, that's the real melody going, the bass sawing away like crazy. But you have to really pay attention to it. All these things going at one time. The other thing that's significant of this era is the bass is moving almost as fast as the top. And that's very, you know, if you think of the music that we've been playing, the Romantic era and the Classic era, the bass was always moving much, much slower. But now it's on an even keel. Sometimes it's even faster, and like in the beginning of this. So it's this kind of chock full of ornament. But then in the same piece, you have one of the most emotional moments you can imagine. So this is another... this is another part of the Magnificat. The Assyriantes. Oh, no, this is Qui Respects. So emotional, but so complicated. You've got two melodies competing. You've got the oboe d'amore, you got the soprano singing this incredible duet over this continuo part. Now, continuo referred to the machine, the technology that allowed these chords to be spilled out. And it could be many different instruments. It could be organ, you know, some kind of keyboard instrument, usually some kind of bass instrument, cello or a bass. It could be a lute, you know, guitar lute. So any of these instruments, they were kind of they're called the continuo that kept everything churning and going. And again, when you think of jazz music, the rhythm section, you know, that is a continuo. So this was the engine that kept it going. And there is a sense of an engine going on in Baroque music. One reason, like I said, it's so much more comfortable to listen to Baroque than the era we just came from. Classical music is always starting and stopping. Mozart and Haydn are always starting and stopping. And this doesn't do that. It's continuous. So that's why Vivaldi for breakfast works, you know. But Haydn for breakfast, not so much. And Beethoven, absolutely not. the complexity is remarkable. One of the things about Bach that's so remarkable is that he, even with just two voices, he can write music that is so enormously delightful and complex that you're hearing the two voices as completely different things. He, his two-part inventions, which were actually originally to train pianists or keyboardists to be able to just have independence of their fingers. Nowadays, we use them also to learn how to compose as well, and it just it's remarkable. So you're going to hear a piece that that goes through all the key, all the chords of a key, but it does it with just two voices. So because of that, you're not going to be able to hear. You can't hear it like that. Instead, it's going to be expressed in terms of scales and arpeggios, which would be, but it's expressed. And the way they interact is so complicated. When one goes up, the other one goes down. Sometimes they go this way, sometimes they go that way. Sometimes so there's these very complex configurations, and your ear has to sort them all out. And yet together, they manage to go through all the chords that constitute a key. So what you just heard, you know, it would be the same as going. You know, but it's all stretched out, right? You know, like an accordion. It's all stretched out. So your ears have to make, have to fill in the gaps. And that's what's so powerful about this. One reason for the trill is the harpsichord has no pedal. Right. So if you want to sustain a note, you've got to jiggle. Try to hear the chords. So in the space of, you know, a minute, you actually went through all the chords of the key, but with just two voices and two completely independent lines. When lines are like that, it's called counterpoint, when you have a line that's independent. We'll discover about counterpoint later. Bach is now trying to merge the old style with the new. The old style was counterpoint, putting these things, but the new style is chords. And so he's putting the two together. He's letting the old style express these chords. And that's one reason Bach's music can be so complex to listen to, and one reason that people at the time felt it was kind of out of date and too complicated. And they were quite eager to get rid of his music, you know, to go to a simpler music. Handel was much better because the chords were so clear. Handel always made the chords more clear. I'll show you a great example of the complexity of Bach is this Wache auf cantata. Very famous tune, right? But that's not the melody. That's what's so weird. For us, that's the melody. That's certainly the thing we remember. Yeah, da 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 ba dum ba dum. That's an accompaniment he created, and he brings in the melody later. The melody is the tune you sing in church. So so this is the example of his complexity. So he writes a melody that's totally different and much faster than the church tune. He then layers on top of it the church tune, but underneath the whole thing is the continual. Bum, 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 bum. Which if I put it in chords, would be like this. Yeah, but you don't hear it that way, you hear. It's implied, and that's what's so astonishing. So you've got these two things going on, and that's all before you get the third thing, and you have to somehow put this all together. spinning out. Just belly just keeps spinning out. Sounds like a complete piece, but that's the accompaniment. And I finally get the tune. Notice that they float like plate tectonics. They don't do it, they don't line up. Like in pop music, the melody kind of wafts in and out, and you can't quite figure out where it came in and where it leaves. And I just think, for me, this kind of makes me laugh because I'm not a musicologist, I'm not that trained. But what makes me laugh is that my little bit of understanding of history is Martin Luther, when he founded Protestantism, he was trying to simplify the ornate complexity of the Catholic Church. And you know, that's one reason you got pews where you have to be kind of ramrod up. And he wanted the churches to be very simple. And the other thing is he wanted the music to be simple. So when he composed these chorale hymns, they're very straightforward. Bum, 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 bum. So the idea is that you don't obscure the words. So the words are very clear. And so it cracks me up who the greatest Lutheran of them all, Johann Sebastian Bach, takes these super clear melodies and makes them a billion times more complicated than they ever were in the Catholic Church. And it's so funny that, you know, he's operating under this Lutheran impulse, and yet he's created music that's even more devilish that way. He also arranged it for organ, and I think it's amazing just to hear it for organ. Organ is the key to understanding Johann Sebastian Bach, because he's the most complex mind that the world of music has produced, possibly, you know, the most complex mind I think humanity has produced. And I think if you understand the organ, you get an insight to that, because we're very binary. We think of things just, you know, right and left hand. But an organ, you use everything. You've got your feet, right? You've got your feet moving. You've got multiple manuals you're doing. You've got your feet also doing pedals with volume. And you've got your hands doing things with knobs, creating colors. But there's this sense to me always of three worlds, not two, between the pedals and then the two manuals, at least the two manuals you're playing. So there's always this kind of complexity. And Bach was, I think, arguably the greatest organist who ever lived, and he certainly the greatest improviser. And he talked about how one of the reasons he spent his life in a very miserable academic church job was that he missed the organ so much. Because he had a very cush job at the court and wrote great music there and everything, but he missed his instrument. You know, he played everything, by the way. He could play. I don't think there was an instrument he couldn't play. He was apparently an unbelievable violinist. You know, and he could play any keyboard better than anyone in the world, but it probably played all the instruments for all I know, but he missed the organ, because that was where he could let his complexity kind of unfurl. But I want to play you a piece that most of you don't know, and to me, it just embodies this unbelievable intoxication with chords, and that is the Toccata and Fugue in F major, just the beginning of it, because it is the longest pedal tone I know in music. A pedal tone is when you just, well, it comes from the organ, where you hold down your foot on one note and you improvise above it. And this thing goes forever. And it's just, you know, everything Bach did was to the glory of God. And you really, for me, you really feel it clearly in this Toccata and Fugue in F major. I'm just going to play a little bit of the beginning. Stop. It's just the most glorious thing you've ever heard in your life, isn't it? But as listeners now in my class, what should you be asking yourself? What's like the basic thing?
It's going to the release, right?
Yeah. How long is it going to go? How long is he going to hold his breath?
Never ending.
And that's the first question. And the second question is when he,
where he
lets go of his breath, what's he going to do? Yeah. Right? That's when you're starting to think like listeners now. What's he going to do with that? Because he's sure as hell is aware of what he's doing. Perfect. What are we hearing?
The melody.
We're hearing the bass pedal. You're hearing the feet, right? The feet that are just sitting there doing nothing now. They just explode. That's all we hear. And I'm not a, you are, but I imagine that takes some pretty fancy footwork. You gotta do all that. Those are big, nice. All feet.
What key is he?
What
key is he?
F major. It's all F major, but the feet are going like crazy over the pedals now after doing nothing for about 2 minutes.
F major through the whole.
Oh, so far we haven't changed key yet, but let's see what happens. It's another good question. When's the chord going to change? Of course it changed. I don't want to get into that. It's starting to change now again. How we start on C. Anyway, I wanted to share that piece because I know a lot of you have never heard it, and it's one of the most glorious gifts to God and to man that we have. So go listen to the Toccata and Fugue in F major. They're all great, but that particular one is great. Let's take a break.